Hello, and welcome to this week's episode of the Help on the Way podcast, where we are featuring April 20th, 1984, from the Civic Convention Hall Auditorium, from where? City of
Philadelphia, PA.
Good old Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. I am your co-host, The Game, here with my fellow co-hosts, Knob and Fig, and let's give them an old tequila sunrise hello, friends.
Tequila sunrise. Hello, friends.
Oh, is this not the Eagles pod? I'm sorry.
Eagles pod? Why is this Eagles pod? I mean, oh, because it's in Philly. It's a Philly show.
So, two reasons.
That's true.
One, Eagles.
The Philadelphia Eagles. And two, breaking news before the pod. We have now have confirmation on who will be filling the sphere.
Is it the Who?
After Dead & Company. And it is one... The Eagles tribute band, whatever the hell they're doing.
surviving members of the Eagles.
They still call themselves the Eagles. Well, I think some of the, I mean, the surviving members of the Eagles are on speaking terms.
The Who still calls themselves the Who, so.
Yeah,
that's true. Well, their members aren't still walking this earth and not being in the Who, whereas the Eagles have a couple of guys that just aren't in the Eagles anymore.
Don Felder's just looking, just scowling at everybody. I wonder now. I don't follow the business of music and concerts and touring and shit like that. But when Den Company first announced, it was for I forget however many shows. But then they've added a considerable amount since the original announcement. Plus, Den Company, I saw, is doing, like, some HP, HP industry show as well, from the Sphere. So, I don't know, it just fascinates me that it's like, you know, we're going to extend this group so there's not that much downtime between this major act, and yada, yada, yada.
Sphere. So. No. It's especially tough. It's not the kind of venue that a band can just swing by for a day, play it, and leave, like with Madison Square Garden. So I would imagine they try and get these bands as close together as they can in a way that doesn't still mess with like their technical abilities to put on a good show.
And speaking of the Sphere, Dead & Company is still sphering at the Sphere.
Sphere mode.
I've kind of lost track now, truthfully, of how many shows they've done and how many they have to go.
It's not hard to lose track.
13 with the Hewlett Packard show.
I saw people on one of the Facebook groups like, "How can I get into the Hewlett Packard show?" It's like, my God.
I saw a very funny point, right? Like, what if that's the night that they like bust out like that's Tons of Steel night? That's...
Can you imagine? That's the night.
That's the night they play a song Dead & Co's never played before.
I just wonder if there's someone going to be taping live from the HP show. Probably somebody.
Wait, can you explain the HP show? Did I just space out and not know this?
So they have added. I'll let you take it now.
Okay, sorry. They're doing like corporate event for HP.
Okay. Like Dead & Company has been. HP has contracted Dead & Company to play a corporate event at the Sphere.
Yes. At the Sphere.
Very interesting. Wow.
And it's a Tuesday night. It's not a regular show, or it's not like they're bringing their people to a regular Sphere show. It's special for the HP people.
Wow. And good for that. That's cool news.
And I'm not one to judge a band taking corporate gigs. My God, take the money, right?
Yeah, hell yeah.
But I do think this might be, at least from my Dead & Company memory, the first one that's like not like, you know, political or saving the earth or animals.
We have a next week's show is a Rex Foundation show, which is
right.
Not, is, you know, kind of dissimilar, but you know, it's for a purpose, right?
Not that I think the Hewlett Packard folks shouldn't get entertainment, but I don't know. It's just
I think we should get to go to the Sphere first before the Hewlett Packard people.
Maybe
I think they should have had a special Help on the Way episode where you and me and
let's just open it up to the whole
Red and all of our guests and our regular listeners, we get a special show, and then the HP people get theirs.
And then what are you going to do with the other...
doesn't sound unreasonable to me.
What are you going to do with the other 10,000 seats that are not sold after that?
Empty. Totally empty.
Empty
it's
seats.
Just for the, it's just for us it's... and our 150 listeners when an episode has Jay Blakesburg on.
I've been thinking, because I've been seeing the Sphere posts on the Dead & Company subreddit, and after this point, we'll move on to the next bullet point. But I think I have been the resident Sphere hater of the group. And yeah. I think it's just because I'm not going and there's no streams.
There's a little salt to it, I can tell. I mean, I feel that way.
Even though I would hate streaming all of those shows so late at night, it annoys me that I can't. And it annoys me when I just see I shouldn't say annoys. This isn't against anybody in particular, but it's like
annoyance.
Right. I see like we're taking our kids and all of our family. It was like 48 people. We're on a plane going to the Sphere. And it's like, I don't know how you get to that point in life just yet, but yeah. Anyway, that's, the Sphere spheres on. And,
I'll just reiterate my perennial point here. You know, stay tuned. Like, there's going to be some event that's going to include, you know, the mass Grateful Dead-dom, and you know, it won't just be, you know, folks who can afford to take themselves and their 30 family members, or Hewlett-Packard, for instance.
I also read a rumor, and then this is the part where we'll move on, that Playing in the Sand might continue next year as well. I forget.
Sure, well, I mean, if it's financially viable, wouldn't it?
They did it this past year. It wasn't Dead & Co. Play in the Sand, but it was a dead band doing a Mexico event.
So, yeah. I think maybe a bit more Dead & Company than I think we'd get post last tour. But anyway.
But they also didn't stream those either.
No. No, they did not.
The 2024 Mexico shows. And I know
all I'm saying is never say never.
Put all the cell phone video together with taper audio, and I'm that weirdo. What the hell am I doing here?
I'm gonna go as far as to give I'm gonna give it the fig lock that we will see some sort of pay-per-view event on Nux. Yes, I'm guaranteeing it, and I'm only doing that because it's very low stakes. Because if I'm wrong, whatever. But if I'm right, I get to tell y'all that I'm right. And that would be happy for me.
If you're wrong, you actually are going to buy tickets for all of us and all of our 150 listeners to all fly out to the Sphere.
No comment.
The one person who has yet to make a Sphere appearance, one Jerry Garcia, has announced, I guess the estate of the Jerry Garcia, has announced Garcia Live Volume 21.
Where's that from?
That is a concert from February 13th, 1976. So you already know it's great. From Keystone in Berkeley, California. It contains most of the concert. It is missing the opening song, which is How Sweet It Is, which is a song I love. Garcia Live 21. Is it out now or is it coming out soon? Tomorrow.
It comes out June 14th. At midnight. Sweet. Yeah.
Tonight.
It will be out in about 12 hours.
It'll be out by the time you find folks listening to this. And those Garcia Lives are typically on the streaming platforms, if I recall.
Yes.
That should be released even if you don't purchase it.
Should be good.
This was recorded.
Oh, Betty Cantor Jacklin. Were you about to say that exact same thing?
You did, but I like that you took it because you are the one who interviewed our friend of the pod, Betty Cantor Jackson.
She's my friend.
My friend. She's my emergency contact and my cell phone.
Yeah.
I think by the end of that, I think love she that is joke. Your friend. So, Yeah, no, Garcia Live 21 coming out soon. And then it looks like we have some corrections from Born Cross.
No, we don't. That's just on there.
Oh.
No. I mean, if you want to correct yourself, go ahead. But
I'm correcting myself that we don't have corrections for Born Cross.
The corrections are, there are no corrections.
So if you think you're getting corrections, you're not. Just kidding on that. All right, moving on to our main event for the week, April 20th, 1984, Civic Convention Hall Auditorium, Philly. Before I go into set one, let me just... This was awesome. I don't know if I was in a particularly good mood. Yeah, like, I don't know if I just was in a particularly good mood, but I love fucking, like, everything on this show. I have almost no negative comments. Set one opened up with Feels Like a Stranger. Then we got Cold Rain and Snow, Beat It On Down the Line, which I forgot to count the amount of beats.
Me too.
Cumberland Blues, Little Red Rooster, Brown Eyed Women, My Brother Esau, Must Have Been the Roses, and then set one ended with Let It Grow. Fig, thoughts on set one?
Yeah, so I did like this show. You say you have no negative things to say. I will say some negative things throughout my little review. But first of all, just a note on the recordings. There are a plethora out there. Dave's picks are not on the streaming platform, so you can't listen to the Dave's picks. I'm sure it sounds stellar. But there are some really good matrices out there. I was listening to one. I think it was the Hunter Siemens matrix that was actually very, very good. There is a Miller matrix that I was listening to, which sounded decent, but you could not hear Bobby's guitar. You just could not. It just sent, there was no Bobby that night. So some of the, I didn't realize that I was listening to the matrix today and you could hear more Bobby. But if you do listen to the Miller, Bobby was way in the background. I couldn't really hear him. The other thing I wanted to say is I had never heard of the Philadelphia Convention Hall, and I consider myself a Philadelphian because I lived there and paid taxes for 10 years. I get to do that. Have you all heard about this place? It's called the nation's most historic arena. It's no longer there.
I mean, I have heard of it because I've listened to this show before.
Right. Well, do you know, like, that it actually existed aside from just, like, you know, hey, this is where this show happened?
No, but Google does tell me that the fight scene from Rocky V was shot there.
No, very historic, very historic. It looks like, and I think only Game and certain others from Central Pennsylvania will understand this. It looks like the Hershey Arena, like it was like early 30s. Like the old barn. Mm-hmm. Yeah, the old barn. Because it was built in 1931, it sits where the University of Pennsylvania Hospital now sits, out in West Philly, kind of just below University City. And the Beatles played there. That's so cool. Beatles played there on September 2nd, 1964, during their first tour of the United States. Tickets went on sale and sold out within 90 minutes, which nowadays is, like, laughable, right? It's like if they didn't sell out within 90 seconds and then be on the secondary sites for like eight times more, it'd be a joke. This is cool. Temple House played there.
And cash or trade for Beatles tickets.
Yeah, right. It's just this little band called the Beatles. The Sixers played there. LaSalle plays there. Okay. So cool place. Cool. Definitely doesn't have, I think, the history with the dead that the Spectrum has or had. Okay, so let me get into my little review of set one. Stranger was very laid back and very well played. It was an excellent opener. At 9 minutes long, I actually found myself wanting more. The band was really good tonight with just extended jams that just creating like a pocket and a groove and like not really doing much with the jams, just kind of making a vibe happen, and that was definitely Stranger, and I'll probably remark about that throughout. Cold Rain and Snow, this one was really working for me. Sometimes it doesn't. This one was working for me. There's a great chugging pulse. Jerry begins. Oh, so Jerry did have this kind of nasally lax singing voice that he sometimes puts on in the mid 80s. Very apparent in Cold Rain and Snow, and sometimes throughout, like especially Scarlet Fire. that was a detraction for me, was his nasally lax singing voice. Beat on down the line, I forgot to count. I think I may have lost count and then just gave up. Decent.
It was 10.
It was 10, yeah. That's a little too much. Cumberland Blues, I wrote, was just getting a little bit loose here, although I listened to it this morning and I did like it, especially what Jerry was doing. Little Red Rooster, good snarling, vocals by Bobby. Otherwise, really like this one. I think I left my office and while this was playing, and I came back up just to hear Bobby's solo, which it was not his best. We get into Brown Eyed Women, another one with good pace and a good pocket. Someone was hitting the wrong chords going into the chorus, so something to look out for. Listen to Brent on this one. We had a very special second Jerry guitar solo. Jerry's voice was again sounding very tired, but he did get the job done well. Esau, I really liked. Nothing else to report. Must have been the roses. The good was Jerry's extremely well-played first solo. Very emotive, very heartfelt. You know, he was just kind of mimicking the melody line, but he was playing it very, very well. Definitely one to check out. The bad was Brent's plunky synth sound with this kind of eerie sound effect that you would hear from time to time. It was just kind of unfortunate. It's somewhat extended into Let It Grow. But I thought it worked better on the whole Let It Grow feel than the Must Have Been the Roses feel. I wrote this was a really good version of Let It Grow. Excellent drum work on this one. The first jam was just extremely long. This is a 15-minute Let It Grow. The first jam was probably 7 minutes long. Yeah, it was beefy. And it was, you know, it was pleasant. There's not much happened, but it was kind of a cool pocket and kind of a cool place to be. The second jam wasn't as long, but it did have a little bit more teeth and a little more interest to it. So that is the first set. I actually liked it more on repeated listens than I thought I would. But I will kick it over to Knob for what Knob has to say about it.
Hello, I'm Knob.
Hello.
I listened to the Dave's Picks, actually. I had this on my computer from when it was first released. I should have offered it to y'all, but I kind of wanted everyone to listen to different recordings and see what it does.
How'd it sound?
It's good. It's a very clean soundboard. I do think similarly to the Miller mix, you don't get as much Bobby guitar as you would like.
Yeah.
But it overall sounds really sharp, really solid. The vocals come out especially clean. I think it's, to me, this is a show that's just about the playing. Like you said, Jerry's voice is in, I'll go so far as to say, rough shape. It doesn't detract from every song, but there are a handful where it does. But it kind of doesn't matter because the trade-off is the band is in top form tonight for 1984. Stranger has a great groove to open. I really like Brent's keyboard tones, the synth sounds at the top. The energy reaches a really great peak in Bob and Brent's little duet section. It's a really fun opener. Continues to be a good groove going into Cold Rain and Snow. It's generally a tight rendition. Jerry's vocals are off. It doesn't do anything world-changing. Really fun, solid. Beat It On Down the Line sounds real fun. It's a fun show. I'm going to keep repeating that. I really like Jerry's solo is very silly here. Every time they reach the end of the chord progression, Jerry's like, okay, Bob's about to come back in with the vocals. And like twice, Bob doesn't come back in with the vocals. So Jerry has to be like, oh shit, all right, time to do another loop around through those chord changes. And he always finds something really cool to hit it at the end. Bob sounds really great vocally tonight.
Yeah, he did. Good Bobby vocal night. I will agree.
Yeah. And very lively work from the drummers on Beat It On Down the Line. I kept finding myself hearing what Mickey was doing, and that was cool. Cumberland is really fun. It's got a really great groove. The harmonies are clunky, but the energy is good. There's one point that's very funny where Bobby and Brent leave Jerry out to dry. They don't even try with harmonies, and Jerry is real flat, and it just kind of stands out there. But then Jerry responds by going nuts on the guitar. It's a really fun, really alive rendition. Red Rooster, Red Rooster, Red Rooster. It's got some great slinky energy in that build-up. Brent has a lot of really great organ fills. Interestingly, Bobby takes a solo early on, still in between the verses. He just takes a little solo, and it's really solid. It's a very inoffensive. It doesn't do anything amazing, but it's good. And you're like, okay, this is fun. And then we get back into the vocals, and then Brent's solo, to me, is the star of this Rooster. It is nice. Both dexterous and musical. It is full of everything that makes Brent, Brent. He is showing off, but never losing the sense of musicality at the same time. And then Bobby takes a second solo, and it's a little Red Rooster with two Bobby solos, and he makes sure to do the thing in the second solo. He makes sure to start going above the neck, and you're like, oh, but I was really liking this. And then Jerry makes up for it with a fast and furious little solo. This doesn't make my pantheon of Roosters, but outside of one obvious blight, it overall works for me.
It was quite the blight, though.
Yes.
Quite blatant.
Yes, I agree. I agree with you there. And then Jerry is absolutely right. Brown Eyed Women is the perfect song to play right after Little Red Rooster. It's got a really driving underscoring. Definitely worth listening to what Jerry, the drummers, and Brent are doing together. Esau is really cool. It's really solidly sung and played. It's got a nice energy to kind of contrast with Brown Eyed Women. The intro reminds me a little bit of like China Cat. It's got a tinkly little groove to get started.
Yeah.
I think it's really a smart move to keep the cool down song, as it were, in Must Have Been the Roses for this late in the set. It kind of kept everything feeling like a party, and there's no slow friend of the devil yet to kind of put that cold water on the party. And Roses doesn't actually work for me here. It's the vocals. This is the song in set one where Jerry sounds the worst, is croaking his way through Must Have Been the Roses. The energy is good. I think it's good that they saved it for this late in the set. It feels like a more impactful, purposeful kind of cool down, but this is the worst Jerry sounds in set one. And then This Let It Grow is really interesting to me. It's an 80s show, and there's a lot of songs where you're like, oh, this Brown Eyed Women is fast. But when it comes to Let It Grow, it feels slower than usual. The energy from the drummers is way less manic, and it's almost, it starts to sound like Disco Dead at times with what the drummers are doing. And I've never really heard a disco-y Let It Grow, almost in the like Music Never Stopped kind of feel, or the Dancing in the Street kind of feel. It really works here. It's a very fun energy brought to it. Bobby's vocals sound great. Jerry takes the Let It Grow jam to some dissonant places, which inspires the band to get a little weird with it. The What Shall We Say section is dope. Hot little jam at the end. In a set that's mostly full of, like, solos, there's not a lot of jams that are like full band jams. You get a little bit in Stranger, and I guess in Cold Rain and Snow, but it's mostly people taking solos. And this is a really nice preview of what the band is going to do in set two. I'm not as huge on set one as I am on the rest of this show, but there is a lot to in set one. What did you think, Game?
I did love it. I really liked Feel Like a Stranger. I thought it was great. Cold Rain and Snow, good. Beat It On Down the Line was all right. It wasn't my favorite of set one. Cumberland Blues was good. I really liked Rooster, and I don't know why. I don't have...
I think we have a show title.
I don't know why. Really, really liked this Rooster. I didn't mind Brown Eyed Women. I'm a big Brother Esau fan, and I'm going to say Esau was actually my weakest thing of set one.
Interesting.
I agree that Bobby's vocals were great all night, except I didn't like him in Esau. And I don't, again, I loved Rooster, didn't like Esau. Must Have Been the Roses, I was good, and I really liked Let It Grow. And I'm not a big Let It Grow guy. And
yeah.
I really, really enjoyed Let It Grow. A fun.
Let It Grow is not that I don't like it. It's just, it's a tough one to access sometimes, but I felt that this was an accessible one.
Yeah, I thought it was stellar.
Yeah, I could definitely see it.
Set two gave us a long-awaited return of Scarlet Begonias into Fire in the Mountain. Then we've got Samson and Delilah, Drums in Space, I Need a Miracle, Morning Dew, Around and Around, Johnny Be Good, with an encore of Day Job. Nob, what did you think of set two?
I really liked it. I really, really did. The highlight of this show is the Scarlet Fire Samson run at the start of set two. It's got a really fun and dancey groove to start off the set. You find yourself thinking, like, okay, this is going to be more of a fun Scarlet rather than a weird Scarlet, and that's fine. But then the band starts getting into the jams, and it's a really fun jam. It's a really patient jam. I love, it starts with both Jerry and Brent deconstructing the main riff, but in different ways from each other. And I think that leads to a cool musical conversation. The band then gets really quiet. And then everyone is just listening to each other. Everyone is just playing and adding just the right touches to keep this thing moving around in some different ways. To steal Fish terminology, this is a hose jam. This is just nonstop hose with the band really focusing the direction of the water. It then dissolves.
I thought you were saying
really...
hose as in like bitches and hose.
No. This is I'll briefly just say this is, I think Fish got it from Santana. The idea of the hose jam is basically that the music is the water in this metaphor, and the band is the hose. The band does not create the music. The band follows what the music wants to do and just lets it naturally go through them. And this, to me, is an excellent example of hose.
The music plays the band.
Exactly. This is very much a rendition where the music plays the band, and it's really cool. And then it dissolves into fire. Brent introduces this dreamy keyboard tone at the top of Fire that's very pretty. For a second, Fire almost settles into a groove that's too slow, but it bounces back, and Jerry leads, and the band does some excellent following and anticipating. I love what Mickey is doing. I'm just going to read you one of my notes from when I listened to the show. I think it stresses how I felt. It's very groovy. It's very pleasant. It feels like you're riding on the back of a worm that solve a maze. Like, we're going through a lot of different places. We're going through a lot of different weird little turns and corners. But it feels as though it always knows exactly where it's going, which is really cool. Brent gets a great little solo. Jerry gives us one last hot solo to bring it all home. It feels like a victory lap after how good the rest of the Scarlet Fire has been. The only real knock to me is that this is far, you know, Jerry's vocals did not improve in the set break. And that is kind of the one thing with this Scarlet Fire, is that Jerry's vocals sound rough, but if you are willing to engage with that, you are going to find yourself with 28 minutes of just phenomenal improvisation. Really like the Scarlet Fire. Samson is then great. It carries over that energy. Bobby sounds great. The drummers are super on. I've always been of the mindset that the mid-80s are the golden age of Samson and Delilah's, and this comes smack dab in the middle of that, and it's just got great, wild energy. A very early drums, but kind of the perfect place to go after Samson. It's a fine drums. It strays from the Samson world pretty quickly and just becomes a mix of cymbals and toms. It then settles into a very dissonant and effects heavy space. Bob and Brent are making very weird noises. It's almost other one feeling at times. Then we get to the miracle. It takes a second to find itself out of space, but once it gets going, it's real hot. It hits every hit you want. Miracle 2. Tonight's a great Bobby night. And then we get to the do. It's a speedy do. It's still full of feeling, but it's definitely on the faster side. It adds some intensity in there. I think it occasionally trips on itself, but the first solo is real hot. It's able to get real quiet, even though they're plus. And then the second solo is just swirling. An excellent peak from Jerry. Honestly, Morning Dew might be Jerry's best vocals of the night. unquestionably his best vocals of set two. They don't nail the transition into Around and Around, but once it gets going, it's going. Brent really gets to show off both here and Johnny B. Goode with a couple hot little solos. The Johnny B. Goode transition is really energetic, really fun. The band plays fast and furious. Bob is singing his little heart out one last time. The Brent solo on Johnny B. Goode is really cool, really worth an ear. Brent starts scatting initially,
yeah,
and then keeps it going. It's really good. And then Day Job is a solid rendition. It's a fun little boogie woogie. It's not a bad Day Job by any stretch. Yeah, I really like the second set. It's a really fun set with some really fun playing throughout. What did you think, Fig?
Yeah, thanks. Well said. I think that I liked it. I think that I didn't like it as much as you. I wanted to riff off of something you said about that snake or the worm. I love that because, you know, and we've kind of beat around the bush about this, but this is something that is starting to really take shape in my mind. Is one of the things I like best about this band is that they can take on an organic form amongst themselves. Like Foolish Heart, for example, Dark Star, like, you know, Scarlet Fire, like you get a feeling, and I've had this sensation with other artists, and it's very cool when this happens, that, you know, they take on a higher form. So I liked how you you know, that was good, I guess, visual metaphor for something that I've been thinking about, that the Grateful Dead and certain other bands can do with their music, which is so cool. The other thing I wanted to say is, well, let's get into it. Scarlet starts with a pretty nice syncopated pocket in the intro. Listen to a Matrix version because, oh, actually, so I was listening to the soundboard and the crowd was so loud when they were busting into the intro that you could actually hear it on the soundboard. And so I guess what that means is that they were so loud that the crowd noise bled into the vocal mics. Is that what was happening? I mean, the crowd is not mic'd up. Yeah, like how else would you be able to hear them? So the crowd was loving this in Philly in 1984. A good Scarlet undermined somewhat by Jerry with that thin, croaky mid-80s voice. The jam starts out pretty subdued. It doesn't do a whole lot, but it does kick into another gear just prior to Fire, where I did like Brent's synth work heading into this one. Now, Jerry's croak voice actually sounded cool on this one, sort of like a beach bum, sort of like Jimmy Buffett, almost like kind of like, like a dude on the beach just singing about fire in the mountain, which I'm sure there are a lot of people like that. But this is Jay Garcia, and it was really good. I really like Jerry's overdriven guitar tone on the first solo. We do get some echoes on Jerry's voice for the fire, I guess, that were produced back in, like, fire, fire, fire. And his solos were indeed fire throughout. I remembered what I wanted to say. And what I wanted to say is this is a Friday show. However, I would suspect that it probably would be a Sunday show. A lot of biblical references in this one. Brother Esau, Let It Grow, I feel, has biblical references. And then we get a Samson. So after Fire, we get Samson. Brent is sending us to church on a Friday night. Must be a Reformed Jew. Really liked what he was doing on the Hammond B3, and Jerry had a great overdriven guitar tone as well. Drums in Space, I like the drums. The space did not take me any place special. Miracle, I got nothing for. Do was a really big highlight for me. It was a Jeff Beck from the Beck album version of Morning Dew. Rod Stewart singing. Yeah, it almost sounded like Jerry was, I don't know, doing it in that vein. I did think that Jerry saved his tastiest licks for the first solo here. I wrote, holy shit. So the Dew is not to be missed. Around and Around was good. Johnny B. Goode, notable for scat singing. And I really like Day Jobs. Day Jobs is not one that I rate too highly. It's kind of patronizing in a way, but good. And Philadelphia crowd was loving it. So I'll kick it over to Game.
All right. Scarlet Fire, welcome back. It was great. It was it was great. Yeah. It could have been the worst Scarlet Fire, and I think I would have thought it was great because it's been so long since I've heard one. Loved it. Samson Delilah was good. Drums in Space, you know, I already skipped. I Need a Miracle. That was all right. Morning Dew. Excellent. 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 Around and Around. I normally love Around and Around. This one didn't do it for me. Johnny B. Goode was okay. And Day Job was Day Job. but Morning Dew by, Scarlet Fire, because, you know, Scarlet Fire is life. But I think Morning Dew, by far my favorite song of set two. Now, something we haven't done in a very long time. We're going to rate the Scarlet Fire. Fig, I'll let you go first. Out of 100, what do you give this Scarlet Fire?
I would give it an 82. Didn't do too much for me, aside from just scratching the Scarlet Fire itch. Definitely wouldn't give it an A. I'd give it a B minus.
How about you, Nob?
This is definitely, to me, the only real knock I have against the Scarlet Fire is Jerry's voice sounding like it does. So yeah, I would probably give it like a 89, 91. Let's say 89. Wow. Let's split it in the middle. Let's just say 90. No, let's say 89. No, let's say 90.
Well, is there any extra credit that can bump it into an A?
Yeah, let's say with the Samson at the end, let's go to 91.
Wow, okay. They showed their work. Game.
I am going to give it an... an 85.
Okay. Wow.
No. I'm going to give it an 84.
An 84.
Nice.
For so
2084.
Oh, okay.
Oh.
So it averages to an 86, which is yeah, I think that probably fits.
Where
solid B.
Where does that stand in our Book of Scarlet Fires? Do we have like a? It's been. I feel like it's been so long. Do we have a list of like what they've?
I don't have. I have a lot of annoying stats about our show. I haven't tracked the Scarlet Fire ratings. I can do that stats for next time. I could tell you who we've picked Mother Trucker the most. I could tell you that. It's Jerry.
It's Jerry. Jerry's got the belt.
It's an easy answer. Everybody picked Jerry the most.
Easy answer.
Book of the Dead. I'll start. While I loved this show, this is not Book of the Dead material for me. So no for me. Nob, Book of the Dead.
Yeah, I was going back and forth. I think it just barely doesn't make it for me. I think it's a good show. I've written down the Scarlet Fire and the Let It Grow and the Feel Like a Stranger in the Dew to revisit. But I think overall, this just doesn't quite hit as much as I'd like it to.
And Fig.
I would agree. It's a no. It was a good show. I really appreciated that Scarlet Fire. Just to hear it again, because it's been a whole long while. But, no.
Can't believe we all said no to a Dave's picks.
Oh, come on. There's like 50 of them.
Yeah, they're all good.
Now, I kind of have an idea where this set voting is going to go. So I'm going to say
one of the sets is better than the others.
Well, Nob, which set do you think? Set one or set two?
Set two. Because it's the better set.
I am going to vote set one.
Wow. Oh, wow. You've just given me so much power.
Yes. Fig.
It's coursing in my veins.
Which set do you want our audience to listen to? Set one or set two?
I'm going to go set two. I mean, it's just been so long since we have a Scarlet Fire. I'm not going to pull a Knob and say, oh, it's a better set objectively. I think there is a lot to say.
Objectively, I just said it is.
Well, that's factually.
I'm just confident. There's a difference.
You're factually wrong because you've been outvoted. Wait, no, I voted with you.
Yeah, what so the I'm hell? I'm actually trying to pull one up on me while you agree with me.
I was trying to agree with you both, and it's like a 90s sitcom where like the main character like tries to like do two things at the same time and then fails miserably.
You can't
miserably.
Bring two sets to the prom. You have to pick one.
And you would show pick
set, two. Set two. It's always been you, set two. It's always been you.
Always been you.
Set two took off her glasses, and we were like, oh my god. What? You're beautiful.
Show Mother Trucker. Fig, who is it for you?
Oh, it's going to be Nom for that joke.
Thank you.
I don't know. I don't know. Because, like, Bobby, I couldn't hear the guitar so much, but his vocals were excellent. But then there was also the Little Red Rooster, which is disqualifying. Jerry had the vocal issues. Brent did some stuff that I wasn't huge into. And then, you know, it's hard to make out the individual Rhythm Devils. This is a tough one. I don't want to cop out either. Let's go with Brent.
Nob, show, mother trucker. Also,
oh, it's Brent to me. More than once in my notes, I went, this is a Brent show. This is a Brent show. There's a lot of good in tonight. I almost considered giving it to Bobby because of how vocally on he is. But there was one person that kept making me go, ooh, and that was Brent.
That's how game always feels. That's how he always sounds.
Well, I'm going to vote for Brent as well because
wow, Brent takes the belt.
We have two votes for Brent. I'm not going to be the deciding vote against one Brentley Midland. So Brent also gets my Mother Trucker vote of the day. So Brent is the brand new Mother Trucker heavyweight champion of the world. All right. Reddit comments. Most of it is about Scarlet Fire. I start with a Scarlet Fire. And then B-Man responds with Damn Straight, one of my favorite shows and one of my favorite Scarlet Fires. We got a Seek Photog, love this fire. And Dale Nixon Pettibon, wonderful show, but that rooster feels long. I'm the
long
only
is
one.
A very charitable way of expressing what was happening there.
I can't believe I'm the only one that liked this rooster. But anyway, next week we are staying in the 80s and we are going to my happy place. August 17th, 1989, Greek Theater, University of California, Berkeley, California. This was a Thursday show. This was a Rex Foundation benefit. It was FM broadcasted on KPFA Berkeley, which I think is where Gans does his show, I think.
You have to ask him. Friend of the pod.
Yeah, friend of the pod. So super, super looking forward to this show next week. A Mighty Quinn encore. That's right up my alley.
Hell yeah.
Give me some lovin'. Fuck yeah. Good lovin'. Yeah. Give me some lovin'. All the lovin'.
I'm pretty sure during COVID we streamed one of the other shows from this run.
Is that why it sounds familiar?
During COVID?
I'll have to relook at my notes, but I'm pretty sure this was one of our little Music Never Stopped streams.
Oh, cool.
Or a show from this.
It sounds incredibly familiar. So yeah, next week.
I'll just lay down some. Good.
No, you go ahead.
Oh, I just want to lay down some anticipation with the audience. Next week we should have a special guest who will join us on the show and also bring us perhaps some more information about Dead & Company Sphere shows, since we are lacking in that regard.
Yes, we're getting some firsthand information about said Sphere shows next week. And then once again, next week's show, August 17th, 1989. And of course, please stick around for set two of April 20th, 1984. Fig and Nob. I have a whole bunch of other stuff to do here before we end the show. As always, please go ahead and smash the subscribe button, and please go ahead and like and share with any and all of your Grateful Dead loving friends and family. Of course, you may find us at wherever podcasts are downloaded. However, you won't find us on a service that loosely rhymes with Mascotify. So if you use a service that rhymes with that, you won't find us on that one. If you get your podcast the old-fashioned way, you may do so at helponthewaypod.podbean.com. You may email us at helponthewaypod@gmail.com. Of course, we're on Reddit, reddit.com/r/GratefulDead, and on YouTube, youtube.com/@helponthewaypod. Any final words from my friends, Knob or Fig?
Nothing from me. Enjoy set two.
No, I hope set two enjoys her go at the prom.
Aw.
No. And thank you once again for listening to the Help on the Way podcast. Thank you.
The living, the art Yeah. Keep your day.